Hey, everybody, thanks for joining us today. We are continuing in our series called How to Neighbor, and we're looking at it from an angle, you know, amidst our busy lives, amidst our busy schedules, all of our to-do lists, what is our response? What is my response? What is your response when we seem to be interrupted by people? You know, we've talked about people are our purpose. It's the whole reason why we're on this planet, is to do life with people and to love people. In fact, Jesus said the greatest commandment was to love the Lord your God and to love your neighbor as yourself. And that's why we're looking at Luke chapter 10 and digging into the story of the Good Samaritan from every angle and every perspective. Now, we've already covered the main characters in the story. We've covered the priest, we covered the religious man, and we covered the Good Samaritan. The story actually calls him the despised Samaritan. But what's shocking in this story that Jesus is telling, a question was asked of him: how do I inherit the kingdom of God? Who is my neighbor? How do I know who to love and who not to love, right? Who's my enemy? Who I can throw shade at? And he tells this story, and it was actually the person who was called the despised Samaritan. So it wasn't who we thought would inherit the kingdom of God. The person who we would have thought would have been end up in heaven, the person who we thought would have been the loving person, the kind person, the person who would serve people, was actually not the priest. It was not the religious man, but it was someone who was despised in their culture. Today we would say it's maybe someone that we disagree with politically, or maybe it's on some cultural issues we don't see eye to eye. You know, in Jewish days, they considered Samaritans second-class citizens. And so it's really shocking, as Jesus is telling this story, that the Samaritan is actually the person who loved the neighbor as himself, who fulfilled the great commandment and ultimately would inherit the kingdom of God. And so we're continuing that thought, how to be a good neighbor. And today we're going to look at it from a different perspective, someone who's not the star of this story, and it's the innkeeper. Right? So the innkeeper was involved in this story, and he just is mentioned very quickly, very briefly, but we're going to talk about three lessons that we can learn even from the perspective of the innkeeper. So I want to encourage you, check out, dig into Luke chapter 10 this week and just see what God is speaking to you. Write it down. We would love to hear it. Share it with us so we can share it with other people as well. Maybe share it with a neighbor, maybe share it with a coworker, or even just your family. But Luke chapter 10, and also go back and watch week 1, 2, and 3. Man, would love some comments there on YouTube. Would love for you to let us know what God is speaking to you through these videos. So three lessons from the innkeeper on how to neighbor. So just to give you a recap, a quick setup, there was a Jewish person who was an expert in religious law, and he asked Jesus, "What must I do? What must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to go to heaven?" Jesus says, he answers a question with a question. Well, what does the law of Moses say? Well, the guy responded, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and love your neighbor as yourself." So Jesus said, that's it. That's what you're supposed to do. So the guy also asked another question of Jesus. Well, who, Jesus, then is my neighbor? And so Jesus responded with the story that we find in Luke chapter 10, verse 25 through 37. Let's check it out. Jesus replied with a story. A Jewish man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he was attacked by bandits. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him up, and left him half dead beside the road. By chance, a priest came along, but when he saw the man lying there, he crossed to the other side of the road and passed him by. A temple assistant, a religious man, walked over and looked at him lying there, but he also passed by on the other side. Then a despised Samaritan came along, and when he saw the man, he felt compassion for him. Going over to him, the Samaritan soothed his wounds with olive oil and wine and bandaged them. Then he put the man on his own donkey and took him to an inn where he took care of him. The next day, he handed the innkeeper 2 silver coins, telling him, "Take care of this man. If his bill runs higher than this, I will pay you the next time I'm here." Now, which of these three would you say was a neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? Jesus asked. The man replied, "The one who showed him mercy." Then Jesus said, "Yes, now go and do the same." Now the innkeeper, he's really only mentioned one time. He has no speaking lines. We don't really know much about his past, and we don't know what happened after the Samaritan left. We know he was watching the situation happening, unfolding before his very eyes. He was watching these acts of kindness that the Samaritan was doing to this injured Jewish man happen right before his very eyes. In fact, in his own business, in his own place of business, he was watching this take place. Now, I'm sure he had questions. What are these two doing together? I have no idea. They would not normally be associating together. There's an injured man. I don't know what happened to him. Did the Samaritan jump him? We don't know. All these speculations about the innkeeper, we don't know. All we know is he was there. And here's a couple things we know about him. He didn't take care of the injured Jewish man while the Samaritan was there. It says that the Samaritan took the injured Jewish man on his own donkey to an inn, and while he stayed there, the Samaritan was taking care of him. And so we know that the innkeeper did not take care of the injured Jewish man while the Samaritan was there. In fact, we don't even know if he did anything, if there was any response, any compassion, anything that caused him to jump in and start helping the Samaritan take care of this Jewish man. So we know that that didn't happen. Number two, we know that he was actually paid to take care of the injured Jewish man once the Samaritan left. The Samaritan paid him, said, hey, this should be enough for a couple of days to take care of him. But if it runs out, if there's more money that's needed, he said that he would pay him on the way back through. And so we're going to pull out three things that we can learn from the innkeeper and the little that we do know about him, but also maybe thinking through what we don't know about him. And so here we go. Number one, don't worry about the return. Just help people. Don't worry about the return. Just help people. 1 Corinthians 10, 31 through 33 says this. So whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. I too try to please everyone in everything I do. I don't just do what is best for me, I do what is best for others so that many may be saved. Here's the thing we know about God's kingdom. It's an upside down kingdom, and God wants us to be all about people. But many times we operate like the world, right? We say, have this attitude of, I can help you, but what's in it for me, right? I scratch your back, you scratch mine. I will help you, but I'm going to charge you $1,000 a month. And that's the world's way of thinking. But in an upside down kingdom, God's way of thinking, he just says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. So man, I don't know about you, but I like to take care of myself. I like to clothe myself. I like to have a house over my head. I like to eat nice things. I like to travel. I like to do those things. And so in the same way that I care for myself and love myself and do things to rest and refresh and refuel me, God is saying, love your neighbor in that same way, even without expecting a return. See, so many of us are so concerned about the return and the what's in it for me that we're hesitant to help those around us, right? We're thinking, well, if I give you this money, are you going to give it back to me, right? Or hey, if I help you out, when I need help from you, are you going to show up for me? Because many times we've been betrayed, we've been hurt, we've been let down by those around us. And so many of us are operating out of this hurt and out of this pain from our past that we're hesitant to help those around us because we've not seen the return yet. But here's the thing that we know, even if it's not an earthly return, if we're working and doing it as unto the Lord and doing it all for the glory of God, he is going to bring a return to us either on this side of heaven or on the other side of heaven, right? In all eternity. And so the world says, I'll help you, but here's how much it costs. We should help people win. We should help organizations win. We should help our families win. Why? Because we're kingdom minded, especially if they're sons and daughters of God. But how much more the world around us that's hurting, how much would it speak to them if we just said, hey, let me help you, no strings attached. That's what God is wanting us to do. Now, here's the thing I know. We do have to take care of our families. We do have to pay the bills. You know, we do have to do those things. And so I'm not saying, hey, you start a business, just do everything for free. That's not what I'm saying. But I'm saying, love your neighbor as yourself. Sometimes people around us need a break. Sometimes people around us need some help. So let's trust God to take care of us and just sow seeds of kindness and generosity everywhere that we go. Let's trust God to take care of us and just sow seeds of kindness and generosity and love, showing people the love of Jesus, the same love that he showed us. See, we didn't deserve heaven. We didn't deserve forgiveness. We didn't deserve to be free, but he went to the cross, right? Regardless of if you accept him or not, he went to the cross for you, and he gives you an opportunity to accept him and come back to the Father. See, we're connecting as Be the Church. We have the opportunity to connect with local ministries and local churches, local gatherings, and just help them. Just saying, hey, I don't know it all, but whatever I do know and however I can help us as a church, it could be sharing a network, sharing a designer, sharing a videographer. It could be introducing them to a worship leader. It could be going in and doing worship for them or speaking for them or giving them insight or just help or just being a friend to those local churches and local pastors. Why? Because we're kingdom minded. And here's the thing is we don't need anything in return. We're doing that for free. Some of them want to give. That's great. They can give, but we're not asking. We're not charging. We're not soliciting. We're just being kingdom minded and loving our neighbor as ourselves. And because of your generosity, we're able to do that for others. And so number one, don't worry about the return. Just help people. Number two, every encounter can be an opportunity if I am looking. Every encounter can be an opportunity if I'm looking. You know, the Bible says, seek and you will find. So in order to find, you actually have to seek. And so every encounter, every person you meet today, tomorrow, the next day, next year, every person you encounter can be an opportunity if you're looking. Seek and you will find. Many of us are praying, God, show me, give me an opportunity. And he's saying, they're all around. Look at the harvest. It's plentiful. But the laborers, the workers, those that are looking and aware and ready to show my loving kindness to people, they're few. And so every encounter can be an opportunity if we are looking. It's amazing when you're looking to buy a car, right? You're doing the research and maybe you settle on a make and a model. And now all of a sudden, everywhere you go, everywhere you look, you see that car everywhere. Why? Because you were seeking after a specific thing. And then now you find it everywhere. I never noticed all those Honda Civics out there. I never noticed all those Jeep Wranglers. I never noticed all those Kia Tellurides out there. But once I was looking for that car, all of a sudden, I see them everywhere, right? Because if you seek after something, you will find. Every encounter can be an opportunity if we're looking for it. Colossians 4, 5 through 6 says this, live wisely among those who are not believers and make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be gracious and attractive so that you will have the right response for everyone. Make the most of every opportunity. Let's be prepared. Let's be ready today to go out. Let's be ready this week to look for every moment to be an opportunity to share the love, hope, and grace of Jesus, right? The good news of Jesus. We don't have to preach it down their throat. We don't have to shove it down there. We can just love people, serve people, love your neighbor as yourself. 1 Thessalonians 5 says something like this. Let's don't sit in spiritual indifference. Let's don't be asleep like the rest of the world, but let's be wide awake. It's talking about just being ready, being open, have your eyes open, looking. Where's the next opportunity that I can show the love of Jesus to someone in my neighborhood, in my workplace, in the grocery store, while I'm filling up gas, wherever I'm going, I can be the church for people everywhere that I go. See the need, take the lead. We've said that a couple of times around here. See the need, take the lead. You see an opportunity, take the lead and step in. See, here's the thing is you don't need permission to be kind. You don't need permission to, you don't need to pray about, God, should I love my neighbor? No, you don't need permission to be friendly to somebody. You don't need permission to show the love of Jesus. You don't even need permission to go and make disciples of all the nations like Jesus commanded in Matthew 28. He's already said, go do this thing. You don't have to have permission to do it. Not from me, not from anybody. You don't have to pray about it. The Bible says, go do it. So let's go do it. Let's be aware. Let's look for opportunities to go and be the church this week. So number one, don't worry about the return. Just help people. Number two, every encounter can be an opportunity if I am looking. Number three, I may not have started the miracle, but I can keep it moving. Hebrews 10:24 says this. Discover creative ways to encourage others and to motivate them towards acts of compassion, doing beautiful works as expressions of love. Man, I love that translation of that verse. Be creative. Think about things. Think about opportunities and ways that you can do good works to motivate and encourage each other to continue to serve, to continue to go above and beyond, to continue to love our neighbors as ourselves. Think about it like this. I may not have planted the seed, but I can water it, right? Every opportunity. It may not be the first time someone's heard about Jesus, but I can continue to water it. And so they see, wow, look at these people out here who are loving God and loving the people all around them. You know, it reminded me of little acts of kindness that we can do, paying for somebody's coffee behind us, or maybe their dessert, or maybe their meal. You know, in fact, I did some research and I was like, man, I wonder what the longest pay it forward drive-through moment is in history. And guess what? It actually happened December 3rd of 2020. Yes, of all the years, the year of the pandemic, the coronavirus, COVID-19 pandemic that was happening all over the world, the record for the longest pay it forward happened in December 3rd, 2020 in Minnesota, of all places here in the United States. Here's what it is. In the middle of one of the worst years as a country, just over 900 cars, over 900 cars paid it forward. Some of them gave $5. Some of them, their order was $40. But here's the thing, is it lasted just right at about 3 days. It was $10,000 in sales. Over 900 cars in 3 days. That's incredible. People paying it forward. See, they didn't start it, but they continued the miracle. They continued the blessing. They continued the love. They continued the kindness. And so I don't know why it stopped. You know, I've often thought, man, I don't want to be the guy that stops the pay it forward in the drive thru, right? We don't want to be that person. You know, like, oh man, I thanks so much. Appreciate it. Have a great day. You know, it can seem kind of selfish, and I'm not throwing shade. Maybe that person didn't have the money and they really didn't have the ability to pay it forward. But man, we don't want to be the person that stops the blessing, right? You don't want to be the person that stops the miracle, that stops the momentum, that stops the movement from happening. But here's a couple of things that the manager of that store said. She said the energy and the excitement was incredible. The staff were pumped. They were energized by the experience. Here's the thing. They didn't even start the pay it forward, the 900 cards. They didn't start it, but they were a part of it and they helped keep it going. They talked about it. They shared and encouraged family members, friends, people in the community. Man, this is incredible. They shared it on social media. In fact, it got social media attention, national attention. 900 cars in 3 days, paying it forward. $10,000 at a Dairy Queen. That's crazy. But here's the cool thing. It wasn't even just people in the line who were a part of it. People actually called in to be a part of this miracle and said, hey, I want to put money down, get a gift card going. Here's my credit card info. I want to pay for a gift card so that if someone can't afford to keep it going, that it keeps going. People were excited to be a part. They didn't start it, but they kept the miracle going. And that's what we have the opportunity to do each day. Maybe we're in the process and we don't know where we're at in the timeline. We could be starting a blessing. We could be starting a miracle in somebody's life where they hear about the love of Jesus and they experience that from one of us. And maybe they give their heart to Jesus right then and there. Or maybe it's just the first seed. Or maybe it's just another opportunity. Or maybe it's encouraging another believer to serve and go above and beyond and love their neighbor and to keep going. We don't have to start the miracle, but we have the opportunity to keep it going. And so we want to encourage you and equip you and empower you wherever you're at to be the church and to really keep moving, to keep going, to keep taking steps in your faith, to keep putting faith into action. Keep serving, keep giving, keep loving, keep helping people, right? Keep looking and making the most of every opportunity in every day. See, here's the thing. Jesus is looking at you and he's looking at me. And we want to get to the end of our lives. He's examining, what are they doing? And when we get to the end of our lives, we want to hear this. Well done, good and faithful servant. You served others. You cared for others. You loved others. We want to hear, good job loving your neighbor as you loved yourself. We want to hear that. Hey, you loved the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and you loved your neighbor as yourself. You may go like, when Jesus, when did I do that? When did I do those great things? He's going to shout you out. He's going to give you a shout out. Like, hey, I saw that when you paid for that person. I saw when you helped that old lady cross the street or take the groceries to her car. I saw that where you paid your neighbor's bill, your light bill, that they couldn't afford to pay, and you covered the cost and didn't even ask for a return, didn't even loan money. You just covered it and said, no, we just wanted to bless you. And you're gonna say, when, Jesus, when? And he's gonna say, whatever you've done for the least of these, that's what it says in Matthew 25:40. Whatever you did for the least of these people, it's as if you've done it for me. And so I wanna encourage us today. Let's serve somebody this week. Let's show some kindness this week. Let's love our neighbor, our coworker, our classmates, whoever we encounter this week, everywhere that we go, let's serve somebody. Let's show the kindness of God. Let's love them as we love ourselves, and let's go and be the church. I want to encourage us, tag us on social at bethechurch.info. You can let us know a story of how you loved your neighbor as you love yourself. You can share us a story of how you went and were the church to somebody and just showed them the love of Jesus. You can use the hashtag as well, hashtag bethechurch. We want to see those stories and share all that God is doing in and through you. Well, we hope you enjoyed today's episode, today's video. Want to encourage you to watch this with friends, share this video, comment on YouTube, like, subscribe, all that good stuff. We hope you're having a great time. We can't wait to connect with you again next week. God bless.